A standard format, I'll give you a bit of background, then I'll give you an overview of the exhibition, and then I'll talk briefly about what we learned doing the exhibition, the things to do, not to do, and I believe that some of the lessons that we learned actually do apply to larger projects like museums and monuments. Can the Science and Technology Museum? It's Canada's only science and technology comprehensive museum in Canada with a national mandate. It has 65,000 objects. I put down here zillions of photos and documents. Zillions doesn't exist, but it's millions and millions. We opened in 1967, the year of the 100th anniversary of Canada's. Canada obviously is a very young country. We get about 350,000 visitors a year. We have 9,000 square meters of exhibition space. We're fully bilingual, French and English, and funding. We get 80% of our funding from the federal government. The rest comes from revenues, from admissions, from the programs, and also from sponsorship. The Dibner Award, for those of you who don't know, was established in 1985, and it is given annually by SHOT, the Society for the History of Technology. And as it says in here, it's to recognize excellence in museums and museum exhibits that interpret the history of technology, industry, and engineering to the general public. And I think the connection between having me here presenting an exhibition and the best its heritage is, again, it's the word excellence. And in fact, that the Dibner Prize wants to recognize excellence in preserving and interpreting technical heritage, material technical heritage. So why an exhibition on the automobile? Partly because we had a great collection of automobiles, but also because the curator felt, and he was able to convince us, that the automobile is actually the ideal technology to use to look into issues of culture, of society, and also, in our case, of a national identity. It's also a technology to which nobody is insensitive. We're all affected by it. I wrote here that it's rules a large part of our lives. Some people would say it rules all of our lives. It has incredibly changed our landscape, certainly in North America, and it's everywhere in our culture. So the question that the exhibition, is there such a thing as a Canadian car? And up here I put some examples of countries, certainly from our point of view in North America. When you think of France, you think of Peugeot and Renault. If you see Fiat, you think of Italy. If you see Ford, a Cadillac, a Mustang, all the cars that you see in American movies, you immediately think of the United States. But if I were to ask you, can you name a car that's Canadian, you would probably answer with the question mark that's on the screen. And in fact, that's why we did the exhibition. We wanted to raise the question. And one thing that the Dibner Prize people really liked is that instead of telling them, yes, there is a Canadian car, and it's so-and-so, year so-and-so, we actually gave them elements of a solution, and then it was up to each visitor, the families and so on, to try and come up with what they thought represented the quintessential Canadian car. And the way we approached that is we divided the exhibitions into four areas, each addressing a question. Is it a car designed by Canadians that makes it Canadian? Is it a car that's made by Canadians, marketed to Canadians, or chosen by Canadians? Two words about the exhibition. The exhibition is 400 square meters. It was, like I mentioned earlier, suggested by the curator of land transportation in 2008. It took us 2 years to make it. So it opened in June 2010, and it's what we call a permanent exhibition, which has a life of about 5 to 10 years. It's fully accessible, it's fully bilingual, and like I mentioned a few of the things here. One of the successes of the exhibition is that it has great artifacts, obviously automobiles, but also car-related paraphernalia, and also great interactives, and a lot of cultural things like songs and publicity ads and so on. This is an overview of the exhibition. The design is very much in keeping with the theme. It's very much a car design. It's got lots of metal, it's got lots of corrugated steel, it's got ways of special lighting to really bring the cars, really make them look as showpieces. So the four areas, There's one area here, one here, and then two at the back, and then a central hallway, which is this one here. So when you come in, you can enter the exhibition from either end. There is no beginning and no end, because each of the sub-themes is self-contained. And then as you go through, then you address the four issues that I mentioned earlier. And you can stand in the middle if you want. It's an elevated platform, and you have a nice overview of the whole exhibition and also of all the automobiles. First section is designed by Canadians, and in many ways, for me anyway, it's the most disappointing of the sections, because you would think that with the kind of challenges that Canada has, it's so big, so few people, harsh climate and so on, it would be perfect as a design challenge to give to designers and design a car that would really take advantage of the Canadian environment and some of the Canadian imagery and iconography. And in fact, people will go through the exhibit, and as you'll see through my presentation, that is not the case. And in fact, the many talented car designers that Canada has produced have all gone elsewhere. Some of them were for Volvo, some of them obviously work in the United States, so they produce cars that eventually, certainly today, end up as imports into Canada, and therefore there's no real connection with being a Canadian car. This is a little bit more promising, the section on made by Canadians, and I was surprised to find out that between 1867, when the first Canadian car was built, which is the one at the bottom right, was a steam buggy, only one was made. It also is responsible for the first recorded car accidents in Canadian history, because it had no brakes, so even though it only went about 5 or 6 kilometers an hour, I think the pedestrian thought that he or she could get out of the way, and the set tailor didn't stop. So what happened is between 1867 and the early 1930s, there were about 100 very typically Canadian car manufacturers. None of them exist today, and many of them, in fact, it's quite interesting when you read the history, that some of them produced 4 or 5 cars and then disappeared. Actually, there's one company that made 2 cars, had an ad in the paper, probably sold both of them and then went out of business. And I think the reason why that happened is at the turn of the 20th, going from the 19th to the 20th century, a lot of the people, the people that were in the carriage business were actually building carriages to be pulled by horses. So what they did is they took their knowledge and their expertise, and instead of making carriages for horses, they made carriages for what became known as the horseless carriage. So that's why at the time you had a lot of people trying to sort of retool themselves and reinvent themselves, only to find out that there was not enough business for them, and then finally they very, very much went out of business. These cars look more promising. The one on the bottom left, the Leroy, was the first commercially manufactured car in Canada. The one on the top left is the McLaughlin Buick. McLaughlin was a Canadian company, but it was very quickly bought up by Buick, and then for a while it became known as the McLaughlin Buick, and then eventually they decided to drop the McLaughlin, and it became only the Buick. The two cars on the right are interesting cars because they're very, very focused attempts at creating a Canadian car going through the sort of the sports car route. But as you can see from the numbers, Dominique GT in the late 60s, 160 cars, like you can't really sustain a company that way. And the Bricklin in the mid-1970s, just under 3,000 cars, not a great success. Something that the exhibition in that section made by Canadians raises an interesting question, and it's typified by Volvo, which is who in the 70s and 80s decided to assemble their cars in Canada to see if they could make it look like it was made in Canada. So in fact, you had all the parts, everything to make a Volvo shipped from Sweden to a little place in Nova Scotia on the eastern side of Canada, on the Atlantic side. They were assembled there, and then for a while they were selling them as made in Canada, and then people said, no, you can't do that, and then they changed their ad to assembled in Canada, and eventually that didn't work either. So again, something that people don't know, and it does raise the question, you know, if it's essentially made in Sweden but assembled in Canada, does that make it a Canadian car? The Model T Ford is also an interesting example. Between 1908 and 1927, there were 15 million Model T4s made and sold all around the world. And in fact, many of them were built in Canada. The reason that was because in Canada, being part of the Commonwealth, they had obviously special trade relationships with many of the Commonwealth countries, and therefore Ford decided to build a plant in Canada, called it Ford Canada, and then built cars basically for the Commonwealth. And you can, and that's just something that you see all through the exhibition, these little bits of information, and if you take your time and you take care to read the text, you find out these very interesting facts. You can tell if a Model T was built in Canada or in the US, because if it's built in Canada, the two front doors work. Because then if you sold it to a country where the steering wheel had to be put on the right, then the right door had to work. But if you sold it to a country that didn't have that constraint, then only the left door had to work. So if you know somebody has a Model T Ford, I guess you could give it the Made in Canada test to see if it was built in Canada or if it came straight from the US. The third section is marketed to Canadians, and that section is made to look very much like a showroom. The platform, the turntable does turn, and there's one car on it. And what we try to show in that section is, and by marketed to Canadians, we focus on two things. One of them is branding, and the other one is advertising. By branding, we mean obviously you take a car, and in this case it was a Volvo, and you call it the Volvo Canadian. I'm not sure if it was called Volvo Canadian in other parts of the world, but by calling it Volvo Canadian, the idea is that people would say, oh, this is a Canadian car, it must be good, therefore I'll buy it. Another example, you take a rather large American car, Meteor 1961, you call it the Montcalm, which is the name of a famous French general. It's also a word that's a little bit hard to pronounce in English, so it sounds exotic. You slap a few fleur-de-lis on it, here and there, and voila, you have a Canadian car, and your Canadians will buy it. And in fact, they did. Okay, this is advertising.
Presenting Canadian winter. There's no getting around it. And for a lot of Canadian drivers, there's no getting around in it. But there are two proven solutions to winter driving in Canada. And though in a way they're both snowmobiles, you probably know the one on the right by a more familiar name, the Volkswagen Beetle.
You're probably wondering why I'm showing you two ads that feature winter and automobiles. Well, one of them is for a few seconds that made me feel cooler. Also, it's the confirmation of what you might think, is that we are obsessed with winter, and we are obsessed with winter when it comes to automobiles. If you can't make a car that you can convince, is that me that's making me fun? If you can't convince people that the car will make it through winter, which in some parts of Canada is 3 months, 4 months, other places it's a little bit more, then it just won't work. The other thing that I also wanted to show is that the exhibition, we were quite lucky in, because we did a lot of research, to be able to have content that was bilingual and was also bicultural. So you'll notice that the second ad was in French, and it was not a dubbing of an English ad, it was very much a French ad, and if you understand the jokes or the comments are actually very much part of the French-Canadian culture, and the same on the English side. Also, the exhibition also goes into something that's also quite interesting, a cultural difference. Many of the ads in French Canada use athletes, singers, and in particular stand-up comics, which was not a tradition on the English side. This fellow was very popular stand-up comics in the 70s, and even today if you look at the car ads and on French-Canadian television, again they have stand-up comedians There's something about, I guess, the fact that they're so familiar and that associating them with the product seems to work. And then in English Canada, it doesn't work at all. The final section of the exhibition is probably in the section in which we actually come closer to answering the question if there's such a thing as a Canadian car. And that's a section called Chosen by Canadians. And what you have, you might have noticed in the earlier slide, and there's a close-up of it. At each entrance to the exhibition, there's a huge car fender. Oops. Stylized. Very, very nice piece of fiberglass sculpture. And inside of each and one of them, there's a computer interactive, which we've called a carculator. And people go in, and then they get to vote. They get to vote one for which of the four approaches for them is most important in determining if it's a Canadian car. Is it designed, built, marketed, or chosen by Canadians? And then the 14 cars in the exhibitions are listed, and then people get to vote for what they think is the most Canadian car. The results at the bottom are a little bit surprising. About a third of the people thought that if it's designed by a Canadian, that would make it the most Canadian, except we don't have any Canadian designed cars on the road these days. The last one was just almost 40 years ago. And in the votes, the one that comes on top is the Volkswagen Beetle. And we think that's the case. 13%, that's about 3 or 4% more than the second one. This is based on 105,000 visitors voting over 2 years, so it's not just a few hundred people on a Sunday afternoon. It's showing a trend. We think that it's the Volkswagen Beetle because for the two decades when the Beetle was being produced, 5 million of them were sold in Canada, and I think a lot of people have very nice memories of the Volkswagen Beetle. My first car when I went to university, my first trip across Canada, my first camping, my first everything. I have something else to add here. So for those of you who were dying to find out, is there such a thing as a Canadian car? According to the exhibition and that too, and with people voting with their fingers, the answer would be yes, it's the Volkswagen Beetle. Unfortunately, that answer is different for everybody. If you went through the exhibition, you would come out with something else. So then that's something that the Dibner people really like. They like the fact that instead of us telling them at the end of their visit, yes, there is such a thing, and it's the so-and-so or the so-and-so. We provide them with elements of answers. They can discuss it amongst themselves. They can go and look at the results of what the other 104,999 visitors have thought of the exhibition, and then they can compare their findings. So what do visitors get from the exhibition? They get a look at rarely seen automobiles from our collection. Unfortunately, the museum, being as small as it is for us, we only have about 2% of the collection on display. So whenever we have an opportunity to really maximize the number of objects on the floor, then we do it. In the case of the automobiles with that exhibition, we're probably at the 12%, so we're much higher than our usual average. It's an interesting look into the Canadian car history and culture. It's an opportunity to look at and discuss a question that has many, many different facets and no clear answer. Nostalgia. I didn't mention that in the exhibition there are a few stations where you can listen to car songs, both in English and in French. You can play quizzes, you could look at ads from the past and so on. And also in the exhibition, there's nothing about how a car works. This was not an exhibition for techies, this was an exhibition for just about everybody looking at the automobile from a cultural, societal, and sort of national identity point of view. So what worked? And I think some of these things actually probably, you'll probably as I go through them notice that, realize that they actually do apply to a larger project. I think the branding worked really well. I think, this stylized close-up of the rear end of an American automobile became kind of the symbol. It showed up on all the advertising, it showed up on our tickets, it showed up on newspaper ads, and it showed up all through the museum. We also had a section called Just Around the Corner, which in fact is physically just around the corner from the exhibition. You can see it on the bottom left. This is a look at the future, and it's actually been very helpful because what it helps us to do, it helps us to keep the exhibition current, So the exhibition doesn't stop the day it did. This section is changed roughly about every 6 months. So you can almost come back, you know, over and over again, go to that section and find out what are the future trends in automobile manufacturing. Currently, it's about biomaterials, you know, using straws and using grain and as part of building fenders and so on. The design, the automobiles, obviously, they're always a draw. We found out four sections, four simple messages, repeated over and over again. You keep hitting visitors over the head with your messages. That seems to work. Sponsorship was very good. We had one main sponsor and we had a few smaller ones as well. What could have worked better? It's almost a, some of it is a repeat of the page before. Some of the interactives, you can see on the top right, this we thought was our big winning, big winner. It's a sort of a toy car, fairly large, about this big, about almost a meter and a half long. And it was going to be part of an assembly line where kids can come, take it apart. It comes out part in about 12 parts and put it back together. And within a few weeks, we realized that it was not an assembly line, it was a disassembly line. This thing, the kids were just beating this thing incredibly. So on the bottom right, you can see this is our second attempt or third attempt at building a prototype. And this one, it's going to be built more like a tank than a car, I think. People have complained, not enough really nice points of view to take pictures of the automobiles, because a lot of people like to take pictures of cars also in close-ups and so on. I put sponsorship again because we thought we would get a lot more sponsorship than we did. We thought an exhibition on the automobile and in Canada in this day and age, you know, we'd be sort of pushing them back, and that has not turned out to be the case. And some people have complained that there's nowhere to sit in the exhibition, or not enough places to sit. A few lessons learned. Going beyond the technology interests more than just the male adult visitor. For those of you in exhibitions and probably museums too, test your interactives or things that have that people can play with. I think Anthony referred to that earlier today, and it's we should all have t-shirts made that say test, because it's the key of a very nice visitor experience. Small number of clear messages. For those of you who wonder what the picture on the bottom right is, I don't know about Europe and other parts of the world, but in Canada, in the United States, the drive-in cinema was such a cultural institution in the 50s, 60s, and until about the 90s. And this is a bunch of Volkswagen going to see a Volkswagen movie. It's a movie by Walt Disney, I can't remember what it's called. Other lessons learned. Again, that was pointed out by the Dibner people. Visitors appreciate being able to decide by themselves, many layers of content. And I mentioned earlier, if you read the text carefully, you would have found out about the Model T Ford and other things like that. Again, picture on the bottom right. For those of you who don't know where, again, the motel became a very, very widespread cultural institution or societal institution in North America. And obviously, you know, the word motel comes from motor, hotel, so there were no motels before there were cars. We were also, when we designed the exhibition and we opened in 2010, we also opened at the same time the Flickr site, because we wanted people to be able to upload their own photographs of their own cars and then tell us if they thought they were Canadian, and also comment on what they had seen in the exhibition. We also got a grant through the Virtual Museum of Canada to basically use the same content and to do a virtual version of the same kind of exhibition. And that has been very successful as well. It also allowed us to go into more details about the technology, but also about the times that were around the evolution of the automobile. Thank you.